Hello there, I'm Mark Fennell, and tonight on Insight, sharing your kids' lives online. It's your timeline, but it's their life. Molly and Josh, when you go back and you read some of the things Dad wrote about, how do you feel?
It's always a laugh.
Yeah, it's
always
amazing.
A laugh. Yeah. You've told Mum that you don't want any pictures of you from her account on the internet. Why?
Because I feel uncomfortable that people I don't know are like viewing pictures of me without me knowing.
I think we have to remember that some children don't want their lives shared online.
That is my right as a mum. I gave birth to him. I'm allowed to do that.
I'm alarmed and I'm a 14-year-old girl.
And I've forgotten the question.
Oh, look at you guys. I think in a way I'm a little bit shameless about the way that I post. I'm not very private about it. I take a lot of photos. I have probably 150,000 photos in a storage. I began blogging in 2009, mainly because I just wanted to share my story of what was going on for me as a single mother, and it was kind of a lonely time for me. So it was definitely a way of beating that isolation.
Tell me which one you like.
I think it's quite powerful to see your story reflected in the stories of other people. So the impact of that is really important to me. I have three children, 18-year-old, a 9-year-old, and a 5-year-old. I do share a fair bit about my children and their lives.
Oh, hello.
Sometimes at school, when we go on the computers, I can search up my mum's name and I can see pictures of me. Mum.
Beauty. Come back again for me? Across all platforms, it's probably like 20,000 people follow me and they comment sometimes. Being 9, she's just a little more conscious now. So if we take photos, sometimes she'll say, can you not put that on Instagram? Or can you not put that on the internet? Can that just be for us? So she's more aware of where it's going, which I think is really healthy, actually.
Enough, enough.
I kind of felt proud of her. And, you know, a little bit like, oh, damn, I really like putting pictures of her. I'm always walking the line between the story I'd like to tell and the story that I feel is impactful and what is appropriate. You know, sometimes you get it wrong, but hopefully not too wrong.
Elena, you wanted to connect with other parents through your online posting. Has it actually done that?
Yeah, I believe it has. And I have people contact me and say that they're really pleased to read about the stories that I share and understand that they're not so alone, and I'm now able to run a business that helps parents as well.
How do kind of sharing your life help connect to other people's lives?
I think it normalises things that happen every day. So maybe sometimes when I feel a bit brave and I share something that's a little vulnerable, it allows another mother who's experiencing something that is potentially really challenging to feel that they're not so alone, to feel that they don't have to experience it entirely on their own. I think that's the greatest power of the internet for me, is that we can connect to each other.
Bruce, you've got a blog that's had millions of views. How did it start?
Basically, a friend of mine decided I should have a blog. And I didn't know what a blog was, so they had to explain that to me. And then they had to convince me that it was worth doing. I couldn't see why anyone would want to read what I wrote. And that was back in, I think, 2010, Father's Day, I kicked off. And yeah, to be honest with you, it's the writing side of it was more how to deal with anxiety and depression. I worked in banks for most of my adult life, which is not a great creative space. So writing was something I did in my private time just to get through that. I always had to have something creative happening.
So what sort of things were you actually writing about in terms of your family?
Mainly anecdotes, which is why it's turned out to be so great for the family. It's all about how hard it is dealing with kids at a young age and how stressful it is. I came into this particular field when it was young, and a lot of bloggers were out there doing perfect parenting. Mm. And we aren't that, and we don't pretend to be that. And so our stories were very honest in terms of what on earth have we got ourselves into? We're so tired. We're getting up in the middle of the night, kicking each other whilst pretending to be asleep, and all that sort of stuff. So it was all those sorts of stories, and I've forgotten the question.
Molly and Josh, you're Bruce's kids.
Yep.
When you go back and you read some of the things Dad wrote about, how do you feel?
It's always a laugh.
Yeah, it's
always
amazing.
A laugh. Yeah. What's the thing where you go back and read and go, ah, I wish he hadn't posted that?
None for me.
I don't reckon, no. I reckon the blog does a good job of kind of just teaching you to laugh at that kind of stuff and not feel embarrassed.
Mm.
Definitely.
Lauren, when your son was born, what was your rule with posting online?
So the very first thing I did from day one was I gave him a nickname. So I have three kids and they've all got nicknames, and my son, I can't even tell you where it came from, but his name is Thud. That's the name that we use. And then I've got Pop and then Squeak. I also initially decided not to show his face. So I started when he was about 12 months old, decided not to show his face. It would be from the side or the back. That didn't last very long though.
Really? Why not?
Because he was just so cute. And I think that, you know, a lot of judgment surrounds parents who share their kids online. And I think that misses the point that sometimes parents are just really proud of their kids and they want to show them off. It's like the animal kingdom. You want to go like, look what I made. And, you know, I think parents should be allowed to be really proud of their kids.
Do you also share the pitfalls like we were talking about earlier?
I do, but whenever I go to share something, I always stop and think, if I looked back and my mum had shared something like that about me, how would I feel about it? Of course, I'm me, clearly like to share. So with that sort of framework around it, I sort of like to think that they'll be fine with it. And I think, you know, they're being raised by me, so clearly they're going to be the kinds of kids that aren't terribly, you know, introverted. My whole storyline is really about motherhood, and they are why I am a mum, but it's more my story. So I try to protect them a little bit like that.
You've had close to a million people that have read you. You've got 20,000-ish followers. When did you work out the rules?
I'm still working that out.
Still working it out?
Yeah, that's an ongoing kind of thing, I think.
When you realise people were watching,
maybe it's less high stakes for me.
When you realise people were watching, did that change it?
Not so much for me.
I mean, I made the decision the very first blog post I ever wrote. So it was from the beginning trying to build that framework of protection around them, trying to protect their privacy a little bit. So it was from before I even had a reader, I made that choice.
I accidentally did the right thing.
It happens to the worst of us.
So instead of saying their names, I called them Miss or Master, whatever their age was, so that everyone knew the age of the child that I was writing about and their sex. Because I didn't want to have to say Josh, who's five, every single post. So it just became Master Five. So it was kind of doing the right thing, but also I didn't do it on purpose. It just worked out really well.
Lauren, your kids are all under 10. How much do they know who's watching them grow up?
Not a lot. It's hard to explain to them. You know, you sort of say, you know, the people will see this and they go, yeah, great. But I don't think they understand what that means when there is, you know, a really large audience.
Has anyone ever recognised your kids out in public?
Yes. Yeah. My daughter, my middle child, is a redhead, so she's quite conspicuous. And I find people don't really look at other adults when they're walking along, but they do look at kids. And so people look at her and go, because she's, you know, she stands out a bit. And they go, oh, I recognise her. And then they look up and go, oh, that's Lauren. So, yeah, we've been recognised.
How was that experience for you?
You know, it's great. People are lovely. People are really, I mean, I've never had a negative experience.
Molly and Josh, you've been recognised in public?
Yep, all the time.
All the time?
Back in the day, it was all the time. It's less now, but yeah.
So how does that normally play out? What happens?
Super cocky. My ego inflates a lot.
I don't know. It's usually just a, you know, hey, I know you. G'day. How's it going? Whatnot. There were some moments where it's just been completely random. Yeah. I remember one time we pulled up to a servo and the lady at the checkout just was just like, hey, I know you. And we were like, I have no idea who you are, but hello. And then another time when our mum was in hospital a few years back, there were like, I don't know, like maybe 10 or 12 people that came in and saw mum and like, you know, I don't know, gave her prayers or whatever, gave her their prayers. Yeah, there we go.
Yep.
And whatnot, like spoke to her. Can I restart this?
Yes, you can.
Thanks.
Like I said, it's not live.
Yeah.
This is a safe space apart from the 50,000 cameras. So, let me go there again. Have you ever been recognised in public?
Yeah, heaps of times.
Yeah.
Very much.
And one time we were like driving through Canberra and this car was going past and they were all waving at us and we're like, oh, that's fun. They're just strangers having fun. And then we got a message on Facebook or something later and they were like, hi, I saw you today. And we're like, oh, that's what that was.
Yeah.
Bruce, are you always comfortable with this?
Yeah, totally. The one incident that was a little less nice was when my wife was in ICU for, she was, well, unconscious for 20 days. And someone went in and sat with her. And I was really not enjoying that particular incident. Just, it felt wrong. I would never do it to someone else that I didn't know. But yeah, that was the one time I probably got a little bit cross about what was going on. But aside, I mean, I was already in a bit of a bad place at the time, so.
Did it make you question whether sharing so much had been worth it?
No.
Why not?
It didn't. Because the blog was such a part of our lives and we enjoyed it as a family. But yeah, that one incident I was really unhappy with because my wife was unconscious. She wasn't interacting in any way at all. And they weren't family.
Mm. Toby, you're the head of investigations with the eSafety Commissioner who, for people that don't know, deals with online safety. I'm curious, that story, some of what you're hearing here, does any of it surprise you?
No, it doesn't. It's actually been really great seeing the photos and hearing these stories because my day and the day of my team is just filled with instances when social media has gone wrong and sometimes really, really wrong. Complicated platforms and technologies like social media can lead to all sorts of unintended consequences, and trying to navigate these technologies can be really difficult. And trying to contain the spread and distribution of material can sometimes be a real challenge.
Do you think most parents are aware of the risks and how to mitigate them?
It's getting better. So when we first started tracking parents and their attitudes towards safety and their awareness of these kinds of issues in 2016, we've seen a real improvement. We recently did some research of a survey of 3,500 young people and their parents to test some of their mutual perspectives on safety issues. And what we found was that about 55% of those kids had been contacted by a stranger online or someone they didn't know, but only 35% of parents knew that that had happened. So I think there's still work that we need to do. Parents can be a really hard group to reach because they're really busy. They often have very little time to absorb messages and safety messages. And sometimes parents get the view that children have this kind of spooky, almost innate facility with technology and that it's too hard and that kids are the experts. But actually, that's not always true. Technology is designed, particularly social media, is designed for ease of use by children. So parents really do have a chance to understand the underlying technology and in doing so, take some real steps to keep their kids safer.
Lisa, you've got two teenagers.
Yes.
How much do you share of them online?
Zero.
Why?
I've always come from the perspective of the child, and when we live in a world where social media has such a huge role in their lives and so much influence over their well-being, for me it's about how do I keep my kids safe? And again, you know, my husband and I talked about this some time ago and we took the conversation to our children and talked about it and discussed, you know, what does this look like for you? You know, how do you experience social media? And if we do post, how could that make you feel? And if we don't post, how could that make you feel? And so I guess as a family, we just came to the conclusion that they can share what they want to. In those adolescent years, it's all about finding their own identity, and it's not for me to influence that for them, and so they have the freedom to do as they wish with their own social media. And yeah,
was it ever hard to resist? Because I'm just going to go out on a limb here and assume that your children as babies were cute.
Gorgeous. Absolutely.
Was there ever that moment being like, oh, he's so cute, I just want to post him on Facebook?
No. And my response to that though, have I ever felt that maybe I should share, because I would see other people's photos and, you know, should I be telling my children how much I love them and posting online about how great they are? So that's probably where I question myself.
Alana, in 2019, you received some news that turned your life upside down. What happened?
Our daughter Kaylee was diagnosed with acute lymphoblastic leukemia.
And what was the prognosis?
So in the beginning, it was just a normal, easy to treat leukemia, but we then found a genetic mutation called Icarus Plus, which turned her easy to treat leukemia into a high risk leukemia. So that meant no matter how much chemo we threw at her, she couldn't get to remission. And so we ended up moving to Sydney for 4 months so she could have a life-saving bone marrow transplant.
So at a certain point, you posted this picture to Instagram. Tell me, what was going on this day?
That would have been probably the first full day in hospital after she was diagnosed.
Kaylee, how much of this do you remember?
A lot of it.
Do you have good memories of this day or bad memories of this day?
Good and bad.
Yeah? How about you, Ryan?
As parents, you're just trying to protect your kids the whole time. And, you know, Kaylee was just super amazing and we were just super proud parents of the big battle that she had in front of her and the way that she handled herself through, you know, all the changes that she had to go through.
So as a family, you decided to do something I think is particularly interesting. You set up a private Facebook group, is that right, Alana?
Yes. So we originally put the diagnosis out there. I think it was 4 or 5 days after she was diagnosed, we let everybody else in the Facebook world know. I wanted to be able to tell the truth and say what was happening in Kaylee's life and in our life, but in a really safe and controlled way. So we only let people in that I knew mentally I'd be comfortable with telling them the real details, because a lot of it was traumatic. And so that was my safe space, and I knew that I could keep updated without having to think twice, oh, did I write that correctly, and how does that come across? A lot of people don't feel comfortable hearing the sort of things that she actually went through. So that was my little safe group, and Ryan would pop in every now and then. Yeah. But otherwise, we would probably put a couple of posts throughout the following year on our actual Facebook page.
So why was it important to have that group? Like, who was it actually for?
It was probably two things. So many family and friends reached out and they wanted to know how Kaylee was going. Still to this date, if I post something about Kaylee, it is the most liked and commented on posts out of, even though everyone loves all our kids the same, they're still following her and wanting to know she's okay. So people just desperately wanted to know how she was going. And the other part was probably for me as the main poster, I would probably let it out. And by saying it out loud, it made it real for me. And it was also a way, that's our little memory box now. That's everything she went through, and some of those photos are just priceless.
Kaylee, what did you think as all this was happening, as mum and dad were kind of updating everybody throughout this process?
Well, I didn't really mind what they posted. I trusted mum and dad.
Were there ever times you were like, I don't really want to take this photo?
No, not really.
When you look back on that, when we looked at that photo earlier, and there's a lot of photos online, does it feel like a bit of a memory? Does it feel like something you have to go back and relive?
Sometimes.
Molly and Josh, both of you have been in sponsored content.
Yep.
Were there any downsides for you two?
It was so fun and we got paid like 20 bucks for each post.
Hold on, you got paid 20 bucks. How much money did you actually get?
So, do you want me to say?
I didn't initially, but now I kind of do.
Which social media platforms do your parents use?
They're kind of old-fashioned, so Facebook.
Facebook every day.
Facebook, Instagram and Snapchat.
Every single second of every single day.
Do you think that they fully understand social media?
At first she was a bit off, but she's learning.
I don't think they understand social media 100% due to the fact that we are from a Pakistani background.
I reckon my parents don't really think about it much when they post things.
They don't know how to use it, like, as well as us teenagers, but I think they're pretty like good at using it for millennials.
Do you have any say in what they post?
No.
No, that's why I'm scared half the time, because I don't know if I'm going to open up my phone and see my face.
I usually like proofread it and make sure that it's not embarrassing.
I don't think they would really listen to me. I'll beg them not to post something and they're like, it's fine, it's just friends and family.
I'll probably let them, just because they're my parents.
What's the most cringe or embarrassing thing they've ever posted about you online?
Oh, good question.
Me at my high chair with porridge all over my face.
I fell asleep in a frozen onesie and my mum took a photo and posted it.
My friend saw it the other day and I didn't hear the end of it for a while.
One of my friends, she went onto Facebook and searched my mum up and then found my photos.
It makes me like kind of mad. We've had a few arguments about it.
Who should decide what information and images are shared about you online?
Me. But since I'm like still a minor in that, they get to have like more control, so.
At the end of the day, I am her son. I do live under her roof and she does pay for what I do. So as a mother, she does have a right.
And a big thank you to those students for doing that. Now, Olympia, your mum who's passed away, she was an artist, she was a photographer. Were you photographed a lot growing up?
I was. So I was her model from about the age of 4.
Right.
I have a distinct memory of various models walking into the house and going into the photographic studio. And there was a little gap in the door where I could sort of peer through. And I'd watched the process. I thought it was absolutely amazing. And I begged her to take my picture.
So could you distinguish between just everyday family photos and being part of your mum's art? Or were they so all kind of merging together?
Yeah, absolutely. When I was 4 years old or 5 years old, we didn't have Instagram. So we had cameras where you would go and develop the film and print them. So I grew up with photo albums everywhere. And there was a big difference between those albums and then what was going on in the studio. So I classed that as art, and then the photographic albums were more like casual family kind of things.
Mm. Michaela, you've been photographed by your dad for years and years and years, pretty much since you were born.
Yeah.
How do you feel looking back on those photos now?
I love looking back on the pictures in the photo albums and things like that as well. And sometimes with photos that have been posted online, I was actually going through some on my dad's page a little while ago, the caption will say, you know, she agreed to take the photo, but she refuses to smile kind of thing. So it's just fun.
Were there ever times you weren't happy for parts of your life story to be broadcast to the rest of the world?
Yeah, I actually opted out of the blog for a long time until very, very recently after my son was born, because there was a situation that I wasn't comfortable with being posted. So when I talked to my dad about it, he said, well, would you like to opt out of being on this? And I said yes instantly.
So Bruce, of course, you're the dad here. You have millions of people who read your blog. How do you back out of that? How does that play it out for me? How does it go?
Well, Michaela opting out was, at some point it felt like, oh, really? What have I done or what have you? But I mean, it wasn't for long. It was very quickly in my head. I thought, no, it's totally her option. She absolutely has the right to say that. And it wasn't like it was ever a problem for us.
No,
it
just, not at all.
Yeah.
And with 6 other kids, he had plenty more content.
We just had another baby.
Starting to get why you have so many kids. That makes sense.
I have a theory.
Now.
I have
it all coming together. Elena, have you ever experienced downsides to the posting you do of your family?
Yeah, for sure. I think when I had my third child, I was living in England, and my first child was around the age of 14. And at that point, things had been... Well, he was a bit younger, actually. He was around the age of 12. And he had started to become more aware, especially moving to a different country and being more aware of who he was and how he was seen by those around him. And I had built a community over there, and it had grown to thousands of women in Bath, in England. And at that point, he had started a new school. He had a friend who was fascinated by the fact that his mother was online and was sharing on Instagram, and which was, you know, at that point, not a lot of sort of mothers were on Instagram, it was more kids. It was his mate actually ribbing him about his mother being online. In a light way, they were friends. They weren't enemies. It wasn't someone we didn't know. But what came home was something he had made in as a school assignment, and he'd sent it home with my son. And it was like a cube that had been printed on paper And it was all these like brands and my blog and my name and like all these versions of me that had appeared online. And I think he was trying to tease my son about his mother being online, basically, and showing him online.
And when that cube arrives in your house, what goes through your head?
I was a little bit confused and a little concerned as well. So I just spoke to my son and we spoke very honestly. And I've always had that approach with him. And now being 18, he's very clear with me what he's comfortable with and what not comfortable with. Mm. And same as my other children grow. And it's beautiful because it allows me to understand them and them understand me.
Indy, you're 12 and you've told Mum that you don't want any pictures of you from her account on the internet. Is that right?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I feel uncomfortable that people I don't know are like viewing pictures of me without me knowing.
But do you have any of your own accounts?
Yeah, but I don't like own Facebook. I just have Snapchat where I talk to my friends and TikTok where I don't really post anything on that, but yeah.
Okay. Leah, how do you feel about Indy's decision?
I respect Indica's decision. She's 12. She's old enough to make that decision. You know, I think it's really important also not to, you know, misappropriate her story or her narrative. A part of me then thinks, well, you know, she is part of my narrative, but then what I'm posting isn't necessarily her reality either, you know. I'm happy to respect her decision because I wouldn't want her posting about me as well without my consent or not knowing what she was posting.
Olivia, you're 14, you're Indy's stepsister. Do you feel the same way?
Honestly, as long as they show me the photo and I get to okay it, I don't really find a problem with that because I'm quite a social media addict. I do go on there quite a lot. So I think it would be unfair for me posting my own stuff to my own audience without letting my parents post stuff that they want to post with my consent and permission. If they post stuff without my permission or consent and I see it and I'm like, can you take that down? Sometimes my mum's like, oh, please, da da da. I'm like, shoot. If I say I don't want it on the internet, it's not going to be on the internet. But sometimes they do try to, you know, push my boundaries a bit. Like, come on, just one photo. I really like this one. I'm like, only if I consent to it.
So how have you arrived at kind of setting this up as the system that works for you?
Well, my dad, with his job, has a very large social media presence. He's very on the media side of stuff. On Twitter, he has over 100,000 followers, including, like, people up to Barack Obama, like, people that are quite significant celebrities. Even though they don't know me personally, I don't think they'd really care about what's going on with me. Just knowing that there's a chance they can see that, I'm like, especially with my father, I really want to keep it dialed down to the stuff that I'm comfortable with being shared to the internet.
Mm. Everybody watching this is trying to work out who your dad is right now. Everybody.
Yeah.
Rose, you're a child psychologist. At what age should kids be able to veto what their parents post online?
Well, it depends on the situation on how these children are portrayed because sometimes, you know, what parents think might be appropriate may not be appropriate for that child, especially if they're going to school. A lot of children tend to get bullied a lot at school. I've seen that a lot in my work, where some children have been bullied because of what's happened on social media. And also some people are stalked, some children are stalked and some identities have been taken. And what I'm worried about is the risk that children are placed on.
Do you think the world was safer for kids before social media?
I don't know. I think probably yes, I would say. I think we're at the crossroads where we're still learning and we haven't perfected the art of posting things on social media. And young people aren't educated and parents aren't educating their young people, their children. So that's a problem as well.
Molly and Josh, both of you have been in sponsored content.
Yep.
Were there any downsides for you two?
It was so fun and we got paid like 20 bucks for each post.
Hold on, you got paid 20 bucks. How much money did you actually get, Bruce?
So, do you want me to say?
I didn't initially, but now I kind of do.
As the blog post got, I don't know if anyone wants to know, but by the end it was about $5,000 a post.
Man, you guys need to negotiate better with your dad.
But
were there any actual downsides though for you, given what we're talking about here?
For me personally, there was one point where I had kids kind of teasing me at school for one specific thing we did. We did a Big W calendar, or not calendar, catalogue, that's the one. And, you know, they were kind of poking fun at it. And at first it kind of upset me, you know, I was really embarrassed by it. But eventually I was just kind of like, it was fun. And I got a Nerf gun out of it. It was awesome, you know? Like, eventually we all just kind of got over the fact that it was kind of embarrassing.
Lauren, how do you rationalise doing paid content with your family?
I approach it with my children in mind. So I'll have to say that at the moment, a lot of the paid content that I'm asked to do is focused on me, so that makes it easy. If it does involve my kids, I'm pretty firm with brands. I have been criticised before. There's a post there. I had a message saying, oh, stop exploiting your child. And I mean, it's Lego. And my child has been absolutely wildly obsessed with Lego since he was about four. And I think people need to step back and think, what does it look like when I'm doing a sponsored post? I gave him a box of Lego and I said, can you make some Lego? And then I'm going to take a photo of you. It was like Christmas morning. It was the greatest day of his life. It was a massive box of Lego. We're a bit cheap. We usually buy the smaller ones. This was a really big one. If that's called exploitation, you know, I don't know, but it was an amazing experience for him. I'm not forcing my kids to act roles. I'm not forcing them to spend hours, you know, play acting for something that I want to put online. And I have to defend myself here and say that I put a lot of thought and effort into making sure that my kids are happy and protected and not, you know, taken advantage of.
Rose?
Obviously, Lauren is one of those mothers who's very careful about what she does. But there are a lot out there who don't. You only have to look at Instagram and you'll see quite a few posts of children that's very, very concerning and very exploratory in the way that they're presented.
Can I just get a sense from people in the room? Has anyone ever seen sponsored content with a kid on the internet that made them feel uncomfortable?
Yeah.
Yep.
Like what? What have you seen, Bruce?
I can't give you anything, but I know I have.
Just certain YouTube families, especially on YouTube, like that's probably the biggest one for me. Like I won't name names,
yeah,
that's just kind of mean. But there's obvious like families where the kids just don't want to be there. They don't want to be on camera. They're tired. They've just woken up. They don't want their dance recital to be filmed because they're stressed out or blah, whatever. And it gets kind of like, I'm alarmed and I'm a 14-year-old girl. I can't imagine how the parents must feel seeing that, if I can notice what's alarming about that.
But if I can talk about privacy, I mean, everything we've heard here is really lovely, but I think we have to remember that some children don't want their lives shared online. They simply don't. And it may only be 2 minutes a day, but after a few years, there's a record of a child's life online, and it's there forever, and it doesn't get wiped, and it doesn't disappear. And I think that children should have a say in that, and I think parents should take privacy by design, which is, if in doubt, don't share your children's life online. It doesn't go away. We live in a sharing society, but we do not know yet what the implications of constant sharing are. We don't know what it does for the well-being of children when they get over. We don't know how much of those images is stolen and used, for example, to create deep fakes on pornographic images, which do happen. We don't know how many of those images are captured and used for facial recognition technology. So your child is forever captured in some system that will recognise them wherever they go, whenever they go. Now, all of those are really valid concerns. So I think it's not enough to go freedom of expression. Everybody's into sharing. I think we need to think carefully about the right to privacy and the fact that perhaps we should do privacy by design. And social media, it thrives on us sharing. And it certainly doesn't respect our rights of privacy. So let's be real about what we're doing there.
Toby, how can we know whether our kids are actually capable of consenting to what we post online?
A great place to start is to ask them and to open that line of communication with kids. I think that kids do really need to be involved as partners in this, and I think from everything that we've been talking about tonight, it's great to see just how woven into the relationship that mutual trust is. Particularly, you know, Indy's asserted her rights there not to be posted online, and I think that's a really powerful statement of autonomy. Child rights are really important here, and consent's a fundamental part of it.
Olympia, do you feel like you were old enough to consent to your photos being taken when they were being taken by your mother?
Absolutely. Consent was always a huge part of our photographic process. We were a family who collaborated. So there was mum who took the picture, dad who painted the backdrops, my grandmother who was a seamstress, and my brother milling about in the studio somewhere. This meant that conversation was a huge part of our practice. Every single thing we did together always had language behind it. My mum didn't choose the one picture. That picture was chosen by everyone who was a part of the photographic process, including my dad, my grandmother sometimes if she wanted to, friends, my brother, myself. And that was the priority for my mum, that if it was a picture of me and I was her primary model, that I would be the one who decides which picture to end up with.
When you were 6 years old, your mother took this photo of you. Now, this was a very, very famous photo. Can you tell me a little bit about what happened with this photo?
Absolutely. So we took that image in 2003. So at the time I was 6 years old. And the picture is a recreation of a work by Lewis Carroll, a Victorian artist, called Beatrice Hatch on White Cliffs. In the picture, as you can tell, I am fully nude. And it is this, it is precisely this that caused the big controversy in 2008. So the image resurfaced a few years later in 2008 as it was the front cover of the magazine Art Monthly. And basically one morning I woke up to see the image on the news, on the morning show, with pixels over various parts of my body as well as big black boxes on another channel. I changed channel and big black boxes. And I was 11 at the time, so 6 at the time of taking the image and 11 by the time it had resurfaced. And it was a huge shock, really big shock.
You had the Prime Minister commenting about it at the time as well?
So the then Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, said that he didn't like this kind of image. It was criticised by politicians, child psychologists, many, many people, parents. Generally, everyone was very, very supportive, but we did receive criticism in Australian media and also international media.
Mm. Robert, you're Olympia's father. You were involved in this process throughout. What's your memory of that time when all of this was blowing up?
Well, other than saying to Olympia, you know, the image of children who are naked has attracted a heated response. You okay about that? And she said, fine. Beyond that conversation, it wasn't really foreseeable that the Prime Minister would lock horns with an 11-year-old child. And because Olympia responded to the press, created a thing even larger than Kevin Rudd had imagined. Because it's unusual in the history of the world for a Prime Minister to be debating with an 11-year-old child.
Do either of you understand why it got the reaction?
Well, people made it very clear what their problem was. Mm. It began with accusations of pornography and it mellowed in the course of the week to statements that it was a child exploitation image, whatever that is. And I was accused in particular, it focused on me a lot, as a derelict father who had exposed his daughter to the public gaze naked. And this was subjecting her to unwanted attention. It would make her a popinjay for every pervert throughout the world. And I had therefore irresponsibly imperiled this child through allowing her image to be seen.
Do you feel like it was fair that you as an 11-year-old had to defend an image?
I don't think it was fair, but it's what I saw that I had to do.
Olympia, do you think people underestimated your ability to consent to this photo?
Yes, and that was one of the major criticisms, that I was too young. What can a 5-year-old know? How can a 5-year-old have the agency? Or how can a 5-year-old know that that it's, you know, that they want to be photographed nude? And I really felt that I had to make it clear how much consent there was behind this.
Lisa?
Yes?
Do you think a child as young as 5 or 6 can consent?
I think it's a shared
parent-child decision, but do they fully understand what they're consenting to? From what I know, probably no.
Indy, should kids be able to sue their parents if they post pictures of them online without their consent?
I don't think so, but they could, like, yell at them.
I'm not saying I'm a great parent, but I will not be parent-shamed. I won't put up with it.
Coco's driving a pink Lamborghini Aventador, which costs about $500.
Would you choose your pet over your partner?
I'd choose the pet. And really? My partner would say exactly the same, I think.
You can't just get a dog and leave it in the backyard.
My cats are pets, so I don't call them fur babies. I don't push them around in pram or dress them up or anything. They are cats, you know, and that's how they live.
I'm Alexandra Palombi. I'm a photographer. I grew up in Adelaide.
Oh, I'm Nicholas Coates. I'm a winemaker. I was born in Adelaide as well and grew up in Adelaide.
Okay, look, there's Madeleine's yum.
We moved to France in 2018.
There's croissant.
Woo! Evelyn was 2.5 and Charlotte was 5 months old. They think they're pretty much French, not Australian anymore. But I think, you know, our core values is Australian.
Oh, absolutely.
But yeah, we live overseas.
Ah, bonjour, ça va?
The cultural differences are vast. It's the best way to describe them.
The French are very private people. They'll be friendly to you on the street, but it takes a long time for them to open up. They're like little clams.
Okay, a bientôt. Ciao.
They won't put their everyday pictures of their family online to the wide audience. The whole thing about Macron is he believes that parents need to be accountable. So it is your obligation as a parent or a guardian to protect your children. If you post an image of your child when they're, you know, a baby and then they become an adult, the child can sue the parent for 45,000 euros or 1 year imprisonment.
Okay, girls, we're ready to go. We've got to go up to Mirepoix.
I've never really come across that thought process until coming here because in Australia, you know, and my generation was raised with social media, so you put things out. We posted images of our babies. I did, as a first-time mum, guilty.
Yes, and I wasn't overly keen on that, to be honest. I wanted to have a bit more of a private stance on our personal life, but that fell on deaf ears.
You know, you have this baby, and you're like, you want to show everyone this baby.
Bonjour, monsieur.
Bonjour. So, yes. I have been guilty, but I have actually toned that down a fair bit since moving to Europe. Dare I say, the French culture has found its way in and you don't want to be showy, you just want to be busy living your life. Don't need to invite everyone in on it all the time. Not Australian. No. I think privacy is a hugely important part and maybe something that needs to be reconsidered, particularly in the generation of the 30s and early 40s who have lived with this very heavy social media influence. And I think perhaps we need to have a step back and think how this is going to affect our children and their adulthood.
Jenny, you're a law professor. Exactly what does French law say you can do with kids online?
Well, the French Civil Code has a right of personal privacy. And the French Criminal Code says that if people post photographs online without permission, they can be subject to a fine and a year imprisonment.
Wow. Do we have anything similar in Australia?
No, we don't. Now, there's a qualification there. When children are under 16, parents in France can consent on behalf of their children. So there's an uncertainty at what stage children can object to photos posted by their parents online. Certainly children over 16 in France can bring that action. And it's possible that even younger children can bring that action once they become older.
So how much legal recourse do kids have over their parents?
In Australia, almost none.
Would you like to see that change?
I would like to see that changed. I think we don't understand enough about privacy and the value of privacy. Hmm. Freedom of expression is important. It's important to human flourishing, and we've heard a lot about that today. But privacy is also important to human flourishing, and I think we really don't understand why privacy is important. And I think we don't understand also how digital technology has changed what we understand as privacy.
Indy, should kids be able to sue their parents if they post pictures of them online without their consent?
I don't think so, but they could, like, yell at them.
Lisa, what do you think?
No. I think suing is probably quite extreme, because I agree with everybody that's spoken that, you know, parents love their kids and they are proud, and, you know, we've got this resource which is used in every single day life. So I think it's suing is an extreme scenario, which I would hate to see come about, because I think it's just all about education and sharing knowledge and having better understanding. And again, opening the dialogue with kids, hearing from the kids.
Or just getting Indy to yell at them.
Getting Indy.
Yell at them. Toby, short of changing legislation, are there other ways we should be managing privacy and that conversation around around how we manage kids online?
Well, we already have some pretty good legislation here in Australia that deals with the after effects of harms once they've occurred. So it doesn't deal directly with the issue of breaches of privacy as far as kids are concerned. And I'm talking about the Online Safety Act that the Safety Commissioner administers. So it deals with child cyberbullying, image-based abuse, for example, the distribution of child sexual abuse material. So it really deals with those acute, well-defined categories of harms. When parents are thinking about what they can do in their own lives to manage some of these challenges, what we were talking about earlier is still something that very much holds true. Learn about the technologies, learn about the various interlocking features that are designed into those technologies to ensure that privacy is set to the highest possible level that you think is appropriate for your circumstance. When it comes to sharing as well, we often encourage parents to identify a group of friends and families that they share with, as opposed to sharing with everybody. There's really no control over what happens on the second and third hop of sharing. And so taking steps to minimise the likelihood, even though it's a very small likelihood, it's a very high consequence of those kinds of things happening, can be done using the tools built into the platforms.
Are there particular things you can do technically, like when you post pictures, are there things you can do to ensure that that image is safer than if you just randomly uploaded it?
There are. Framing's really important. Very proud parents posting images of their child's first day at school. And often those images are taken outside a family home. The child's in school uniform. You can see the street number of the home. It doesn't take a lot of inventiveness to crowdsource, and sometimes we do see this happening in large networks, of crowdsourcing the location of that child. You can also strip out what's called metadata from your photos. A lot of platforms do this automatically, but it's a good habit to get into. If you've taken the image using a smartphone that's GPS enabled, that metadata can contain the latitude and longitude of where that photo was taken, a whole range of other identifying information. So there are tools that are built into your operating system that can help you remove that metadata, lots of good guides online. But there's some of the sort of pre-processing steps that we think are really sensible to go through in conditioning your photos for the world at large.
Does anyone ever do that? Does anyone ever strip metadata from their photos before posting it online? Jeannie does. Anyone else? You do? No? Bruce?
You know what?
Bruce is like, what is a metadata? Lauren, you are recently retired your 9-year-old from the internet. Mm-hmm. Why?
The reason I did that is because, in my opinion, when you have a baby and a toddler, their stories are also mum's stories. Everything they do is part of mum's existence. You know, if they have a bad night of sleep, mum's had a bad night of sleep. If they're having tantrums, mum's having to deal with that challenge of the tantrum. But when my kids started school, I've only got my eldest two are in school now, mum and child sort of go in two different directions. Mm. Their story is no longer my story. So I just stopped, and I made that decision at about age 8 that it would be it. But leaving the door open for, you know, in a few years' time, if he decides that he's all right with, you know, provided I'm still doing this as a job, if he decides that he wants to jump back in, then he can, but I wanted to wait until I was really sure that he was really able to give the go-ahead. I did reserve the right to boast about him on his birthday. that is my right as a mum. I gave birth to him. I'm allowed to do that.
Bruce, you've lived through this. You've sort of stopped writing about your family. Why did that happen?
What happened is I got elected as a councillor.
Hands up, who shocked? Anybody?
I didn't mean to. I just
common theme with you, Bruce. Common theme.
So that changed everything because, firstly, I'm not saying I'm a great parent, but I will not be parent-shamed. I won't put up with it. Secondly, I will not have anyone throw anything negative at my daughter, any of my kids, but I just won't have it. So I'm going to step back, unfortunately, and stop blogging. And I think it was a sensible decision because when you're an elected official, you do get people being extremely negative towards you, and it does, I think, rub off on the family. I think that's why so many people who are politicians keep the family out of it.
Josh, Molly, Mish, how do you feel about the legacy of your family that lives online forever and ever? Amen.
I love it.
I love it.
I love it, yeah. Going to jump on that train.
I might have opted out myself, but I love the fact I can go back and read stories of when the kids were younger. I moved away about 9 years ago. So it's been a really great way for me to sort of keep up to date with what's going on with my younger siblings. And there are stories of people on there who have now passed away, and it's great to be able to reminisce on that.
Kaylee, Ryan, there's going to be photos of you online forever. Mm-hmm. When you look back at those photos now, how do you feel, Ryan?
Super proud of the journey that we went through. I mean, it was a really hard time, but there were some really good times out of it too. So it is okay to look back on them and to relive those moments again.
I'll give the last word to you, Kaylee. How do you feel?
Good.
Thank you all so much for sharing. It's been an incredible show. And with that, I shall leave you. My name's Mark Fennell, and thank you for watching Inside.